Hi, good evening, everyone. I think we will have to buckle up because in terms of timing, we might run into some issues. So if I'm going too fast, don't hesitate to shout to slow me down. I'm going to talk to you this evening about microservices and what we have done within TVH in context of microservices in the hope that what we have encountered and where we bumped upon that, this might help you, that our learnings might be of value to you. Before we start with the details of what our experience was, what I would first like to do is talk to you about what we understand as microservices, because we have seen that in the market there are a lot of different conceptions of what microservices mean. For us, microservices have three main pillars where they stand upon and that are like mandatory for us to be considered as microservices, because that is within our perspective what actually brings the value of microservices. So let's start first with the technical aspects of microservices. For us, a microservice is actually a piece of code that stands on its own. So it runs in its own process, it has its own data, it's built stateless, so for scalability reasons, obviously. It's deployed independently, very important. You want to move fast in microservices, so each service should have its own life cycle. And it isolates faults. So meaning, if you have multiple microservices and they are depending upon each other, you should be able to operate your microservices even if there is something wrong with your dependencies. Very important. Then the second aspect is the more architectural aspects. So what you want to do in a microservices ecosystem or in a system where you combine microservices with more monolithic code is try to divide your ecosystem in the correct partitions. So the concept of microservices is that you can identify boundaries in your system where you can have individual cells of functionality living. Microservices expose APIs, so what you would want is probably for external microservices is to have some kind of an API gateway in place that can offload specific functionalities like monetization of your microservices or security of your microservices in a solution that you put in front of your microservices ecosystem. Microservices can be polyglot, so meaning you can combine all different types of technologies and you could leverage the technology that best suits the need for a specific use case. Microservices have a single responsibility in the system and they are what we call choreographed. This goes together with the fact that you use smart endpoints and dumb pipes. So before, for the people that have done ESB implementations, what you did there was you have your ESB, you couple systems, you link systems together, and part of the logics go on the enterprise service bus. In microservices, you don't use that pattern. With the ESB paradigm, the consequence was if something was wrong with the logic on the bus, then your whole system could fail. In microservices, because you built that resilience between the services, you can operate if pieces of your software ecosystem start failing. Then the third component is equally important or maybe even more important than the other two, and that is the organizational aspect. So what you want to do is within your organization, you want to identify teams that can work around a specific business capability. So where now you have in the more monolithic context people that can work on every piece of the system and that not always take ownership of that. In a more microservices-minded context, what you want to do is you want to isolate a chunk of the system and give end-to-end ownership to the people that operate that cell of your system. You're working with products, not projects. Maybe a quick test for people that have been involved in big projects. How many people have been doing projects that, for example, take multiple years before they get delivered? OK, a few. And for these projects, when the project was delivered, was the outcome always what the business was actually expecting? So this is one of the main challenges of big projects, big chunks of functionality that is being delivered. You get the consequence that because the time that passes by, that by the time you launch a project, that your reality has completely changed and that your project is no longer answering on the needs that you had at that specific moment. When we are working with products, the idea is that you're in a very tight loop with the business where you validate and you check what is being delivered, that this is actually answering to the needs of the business. Very important. This doesn't mean chaos. This means that what you're trying to do is make sure with the business that you have short-term business value that is being realized, but longer term that you also have a clear vision where you want to go. Small teams, so small teams that get complete autonomy. And the idea of you build it, you run it. You build it, you run it means that if you give end-to-end ownership to an individual team, that they will also be responsible for the operational side, that you give them as much control as possible so they can end-to-end influence how a service operates. So there is a kind of decentralized governance. There is no hierarchical top-down structure, but each team gets a real chunk of the system that they can own for themselves. Okay, so I have put this slide because this is, in our context, one of the most important elements in terms of microservices. This is ownership and autonomy. People can take responsibility for a chunk of the code, and they get the freedom within boundaries, which I will explain later, to realize things how they want to realize them. One reflection to make, as most companies are not the size of the really big companies, like, for example, a Google, you have to be aware of that some decisions might have consequences that you don't want. Like, for example, from our side, from the perspective of technologies, we try to limit the number of technologies within our microservices ecosystem. This has multiple reasons. For example, training, knowledge sharing, the flexibility to shift people between teams, if this is relevant. These are all elements where we say we want to centralize the amount of technologies that we want to use. On the other side, there are microservices that, for example, don't need to be this hyper-resilient because they are not relevant enough in a business process if they are down for a few moments. Or on the other side, you would want certain microservices that you want to build as with the mindset they have to be always on. There are a lot of dependencies on them, and we do not want to replicate the whole data system to a whole bunch of microservices. Like, for example, if you take item data, we have, I think, 16 million items in our database. You don't want to replicate that over 100 microservices. Then we are now at the moment doing a very big exercise where we are trying to take our current landscape, which is a Progress in-house ERP application, and we are trying to convert it to a microservices landscape. So what we want to do is first see where do we differentiate in terms of the functionalities that we are building, and therefore we are looking at, for example, building business capability maps. So creating an overview of where are the capabilities within our ecosystem. This is one of the techniques on how to determine our microservices ecosystem, or that we use as input for our microservices ecosystem. Another method that we have tried, but we are still in the beginning there, is the domain-driven design exercises that we are doing now for specific teams. And we are also doing static code analysis of our current code base from the perspective of learning on the ecosystem that we have. So static code analysis and also behavior of users within our ecosystem. One of the things that we have noticed, we started quite early with microservices, and I have to say we cut some corners. And there, one of the things that we did was not getting our bounds correct. What you want to do in a microservices landscape is really invest time in trying to determine what the logical cells are within your ecosystem. So on one hand, you want to have boundaries that are stable, that are clear, that are limiting scope of functionality. And there, the domain-driven design is, of course, an answer to solve this issue. Don't underestimate the importance of this thing. Sometimes you have to consider the size of microservices. And there has been a lot of discussions on how big a microservice should be. Well, I think there is no clear answer, but the guidelines that we take is, on one hand, we know that microservices can be too big if you tend to see that you're cramping up functionalities that are not living in the same space. So some kind of, I would not say objective process, but a gut feeling that you have when you're building functionality. What we have said is, for example, rules like you can only have 2,500 lines of code per microservice. Well, this is not realistic. We will not make our services this small. So what we do now as an approach is we build pieces of functionality together from the perspective of later bringing them to microservices. In the development process, they are already facilitated as separate cells, but they are not separated in different services. And when we learn more about the domain, we try to start splitting the services in, splitting the monolithic development into multiple services when we learn more about the ecosystem. This has consequences, of course, because now you have software that was once in one chunk. You pull it apart, you introduce network, transaction scopes change. So it has consequences, but we try to model as good as possible. But for the refactoring, we try to do it as much as possible into one big project. Define clean, well-considered APIs. Also something that we underestimated, so we started to do what we thought was REST, but what actually was some kind of a REST-looking RPC communication. So we didn't have any evolvable APIs. If you really, certainly for external APIs, if you really want to have evolvable APIs, read the guidelines of REST and implement them all. Use them as a checklist and validate that your APIs are actually evolvable and are adhering to the REST standards. Synchronous versus asynchronous communication for Chris has mentioned a lot on this topic. Well, to be honest, we haven't figured out exactly where for us the boundaries between synchronous and asynchronous communication live. We have use cases for both. And what we see if we look at the market, for example, now with new technologies as service meshes, which allow interaction between microservices in a synchronous way, we see that the industry is still working in a service-to-service communication way that is not per se message-based only. So what our approach currently is on our parts ecosystem is we want to pragmatically try to determine what makes most sense in terms of synchronous versus asynchronous communication. Design for flexibility. When you are doing development, it has been a long time a tendency to try to build the perfect domain model. And then once you have that perfect domain model, the day after, somebody comes with a new requirement that really throws a brick in that domain model, where you say, ah, all our work is lost. Now, the approach is, in terms of microservices, you want to do refactoring when it's required, and you want to have that mindset when you're thinking about your code. Design for requirements that will change over time. This is a I think quite evident one, but I want to mention it anyway. Iterate and reflect on what you have done. This is the only way to get your software ecosystem better. The big challenge there is sometimes that you have the pressure of the business to bring new functionality. But refacilitating something in a better way sometimes pays off in the long run. Think about that. Get your observability right first for your microservices ecosystem. You have a very complex landscape. If you have no visibility in your landscape and you need to debug, it will be very painful. So make sure that you have complete visibility in your ecosystem, not only on code level or on network components. One of the things we have learned in terms of monitoring is that you really need a new set of monitoring tools. Most people know the Prometheus and Grafana monitoring tools, so we started with them. And then we saw that long-time data retention became difficult, and there we said, OK, we need some extra database to store the time series, and we combined it with InfluxDB, but it was still not an answer for the requirements that we have. And then we switched to Google Stackdriver. And there, we are still on Google Stackdriver, but it's also not perfect. It could be more feature-rich, so not we don't have a clear answer here. We have a lot of services, and you want to document them. Don't underestimate the complexity of an ecosystem. It will grow very fast. You will have a lot of services. If you don't catalog them, if you don't catalog the relations, it will be very, very, very difficult to get a grip of your ecosystem. So here is some, for the art lovers, here is some abstract art by Amazon, by Twitter, and by Netflix, which represent how they integrate their services. Next step, get your defaults right. So for example, we are running JVMs. In the first stage, we did not have guidelines. They were not tuned, and we lost a lot of resources. Make sure that you think about what you want as guidelines and propagate them to the teams. Here, you see this lady probably did not have the intention for this sudden upscaling. Well, make sure you're not in the same situation where you did not foresee the fact that added volume was required in your system. So test it beforehand. Design for failure. So make sure that everything what could go wrong has been validated. And test your ecosystem if some havoc happens within your ecosystem. So make sure that, for example, you simulate behavior of services that are not behaving as expected. Automate and test your security and upgrades. So this is we are in the process of one-click updates if security patches are released. It's very important if you have external services. Automate as much as possible. So if you have a microservices ecosystem, make sure that you're ready for the amount of people, the amount of services that will come to you. So make sure that everything gets automated in terms of your onboarding process. What we did for new teams, we made some demo microservices to show the best practices of how a microservice, how we see the ideal microservice. If you take the time to set up a few use cases, you learn a lot by doing it, but you also set a kind of standard. So if you give sample applications to your development teams, make sure that they make sense and that it's not a proof of concept where you did not think about what the consequences are. And what we also learned is there is a lot of best practices that are available that you better just adhere to. Like, for example, the 12-factor app best practices and things like that. Read them and validate what you're doing, that it's actually happening in practice. One of the things that we learned the hard way is that these ecosystems are still evolving. And I mean for all providers that Kubernetes releases are coming fast. Services are sometimes initially not high available, of consequences in network topologies that change. We had a hard time refactoring because the ecosystems had new features that we had to adhere to. We are in the business of continuous evolution. So if you start with microservices, don't see it as a five-year project. We are going to do microservices in the next 5 years. Partitioning your ecosystem is important, so you have individual cells that can be retransformed over time. I think if we look back in history on how IT looked 10 years ago, and if we look on how it looks now, it has fundamentally changed, while the rate of change will only become bigger. So make sure if you start with microservices that you have some competences in your organization that track these changes, because things that you now have to do manually or have to do the hard way can be refacilitated in new releases or new initiatives. Like, for example, people that have started with the Netflix stack, circuit breaking was then part of the libraries. Now, with Istio, this is part of the platform. So you want to go the way that is structurally for all your services. So really invest in keeping up to date. Make sure you provide everything to the squads in terms of what they need. Make sure you have support teams. So Jan mentioned the Cloud Squad. They also support our microservices initiatives with questions, but with the mindset to empower them so that all the knowledge can go to the operational squads. Start small. Don't take too much hay on your fork, or how do we say it in English? Make sure that you do a proof of concept to assess what complexity is ahead. So maybe a quick recap of all what we've talked about. The main takeaways, if you leave this session, is, again, start small. Don't underestimate the complexity. There's a lot more complex ecosystem that pays off at scale and that pays off in terms of business functionality delivery. But a lot of complexity is added. Act on multiple domains. So we talked about the technical domain, the architectural domain, and the organizational domain. Just working on one facet won't work. You can't do microservices if you don't take agile with it. It won't work. It's a complete end-to-end mindset that you have to implement. Get your boundaries of your ecosystem right. Don't be naive about it. Really invest time to see where the real boundaries in your ecosystem live. And in the worst case, you have to change your organization to what makes sense. Design for flexibility and evolvability. And make sure that you have complete insight in your microservices ecosystem. You aren't Google, so think pragmatically of what works for you. But don't make shortcuts that touch upon the fundamentals of microservices. And technology is not perfect in this fast-evolving world. So if there are still questions on cloud of microservices, we will be glad to answer them now or maybe later with a glass of beer. Thank you. We have now implemented the agile methodology within our IT organization. But historically, at TVH, we have always been a company that has a very evolving system. Like, for example, our problems are not the same as with some other stories that you hear in the IT landscape. We already did in our legacy application daily delivery and things like that. So we already could offer some of the advantages of microservices. And the business was also already a little bit used to the fact that they could get change at a quite big pace. What was one of the challenges is the fact that they thought that we were doing perfect job, but they did not realize that we had all these dependencies. And now with microservices, we are already starting to make clear that they will get new features that can be implemented faster because of the control over these boundaries. So they see value in it, but it really takes a lot of effort to bring them the story, to show them exactly on where the value lives, and that getting base context right also takes quite some effort. So it's a very good question, and it's something that you should consider very well on how you bring it to your business, and really consider what is what are valuable selling points within your organization to get business traction. No. This was a decision that was driven from within IT. We have started this initiative, and now we are bringing this to our management. So we have first set up a context where we can prove the value for ourselves, where we are all convinced that this is the way forward. Now we want to bring the rest of the organization in this approach.
Basically, if I can add something, we were in a situation where because we were running, and for big part still running, a monolith, if the monolith goes down, everything goes down. And that's one of the reasons we started doing microservices. We basically, the business will never want this. What the business does want is that your system remains up, and that if one part of your system breaks, that the rest remains up. And that's one very good reason to move to microservices. And basically, it came from IT, and we essentially said we can't continue like this anymore. It wasn't manageable anymore. That's a big difference. But there was no change in the fact that we were suddenly releasing constantly versus once every two years or something, because we have always done that. When I started 13 years ago, it was actually so extreme that an end user, and that was not necessarily a manager, but a significantly important end user would just call and say, I want this. And he would get it. And he would get it the same day if it was feasible to implement in a single day. That's something we have always had.
But our model was not scalable from the perspective of dependencies and also from the perspective of technology. Our ERP application is made in OpenEdge, Progress OpenEdge, which is technology that doesn't have a lot of development capacity on the market, and that has not a strong roadmap in terms of evolution, and is for us it's really valuable to make our future ecosystem sustainable industry standard ecosystem. So we combine that OpenEdge technology with new Java microservices, but not in a way where we say these are two speeds of change, but in a way where we take chunks of our OpenEdge ecosystem that we enrich with Java applications, and where we disable the functionality within OpenEdge.
Other questions?
How many microservices do you run today, and how do you solve the
self-discovery? Could you repeat the second part of the question?
How did you solve the service discovery problem in microservices?
Yeah. The amount of microservices we run today is around 60. I have to say, we are still in the ramp-up process. And we have proven to our business that we have a control over the technology. So the next step is the upscaling. How we do our service discovery today is just use the Kubernetes service discovery facilities.
Service names, basically within the namespace, and out of the namespace, we have DNS names. So when the DNS names resolve to a service within the proper namespace on that way. But no advanced things there. Yes.
Sorry?
We migrated to Google Apps, I believe, in 2013. We actually managed to crash Google Drive during the migration, which is interesting. So never assume that something will work. But it went really well aside of that, from that, and then they fixed it, and then everything worked, and we are very happy with Google Apps. So it was an obvious thing to look at. The moment we started doing really heavy cloud computing and like stuff like Kubernetes and microservices, you have the advantage that Google actually like invented Kubernetes, so it was also an obvious choice to look at. And then we evaluated different options, and it was just a simple start, I believe. We looked at Amazon as well, certainly.
We believe that Google is differentiating in what is actually brought to us as cloud functionality. Like the Kubernetes, as you were mentioning, was built from within the expertise of Google, so they were running their container ecosystem locally. They brought all that knowledge into a package, but we also see, like for example, in terms of what is being delivered in context of IoT, like for example, things like HTPU, I think only Google has them. So we see a lot of differentiation in technology. So we don't see Google as an infrastructure provider that just provides us compute capacity in the cloud, but we see them as a partner that brings value-added services. Before it was indeed, as you were mentioning, the Google Apps, Google Maps. There were a lot of services that they were the first provider, and that's why for us we are still in a good understanding with Google, and we see certainly Google as one of our strategic partners in the future.